Yeah, so I'm going to talk about GitHub Actions in open source projects, so public GitHub repos basically, and also to kind of replace Travis with GitHub Actions. So there was some question at the previous presentation about the Travis, so I try to make a small comparison, something else than 10 versus 20 thing. Yeah, so first of course, who am I? And then remembering that I have two screens. Here. Oh, sorry. Agenda, of course, first. So, going to talk first who am I, then about the GitHub Actions basics. So, just quick overview what I'm talking about in general. Then, example moving from Travis to GitHub Actions with Java application, and then kind of completely new CI for the robot framework. Which is basically RPA and test automation framework, and written completely in Python, but more about that at the fourth point. And then time for questions and hopefully good answers. So I have started my IT career, let's say, being a tester and worked almost 10 years as a tester. And then at the Eficode, broadened my view a bit towards different clouds and, towards CI in general also. And yeah, that's it. So hopefully getting some patches also this year. Not have had time yet, but hopefully at least one Kubernetes certification is coming. But yeah, then that's the advertisement part, then going to real deal. So the GitHub Actions basics. So it's basically just CI tool which was announced at 2018. And my first experiences about GitHub Actions are from beginning of last December. So as mentioned in the previous thing, the things that we done in 2 months back could have looked a bit different at the beginning of this month, or at the beginning of January and at the beginning of this month. So it kind of quite rapidly advancing, but still there are some things that there are some things still that our workarounds are still needed, so it hasn't improved some parts, but more of that later. The most important thing I think is that it's free for public repos. The private repos, it was mentioned that the pricing is good or cheap for those also. But at least when I looked those, I can't say anything. I haven't paid for CI ever. So hard to compare. But just thing is that even though it has Windows and macOS there, those are not the same quota than the Linux. So there's 2,000 minutes for Linux, but with Windows that's only half, and with macOS it's only 10th of the original, or the 2,000 minutes. And I guess the main environments are available, Linux, macOS, and Windows. But because of the pricing, I think at least the private side is kind of driving, run everything at Linux side. I think it's quite easy to get started with. Just create the YAML files and let it go. And the concurrent runners thing is also quite a nice thing. And the ready-made actions, which, yeah, the security was mentioned, but that's, I'm going to go back to that a bit later. Currently, everything, this is the main thing you should remember. Git tags are not immutable, which means that tags are not good thing, as well as branches are not good thing. But more about that a bit later. And then first, the example, because I think through the examples, the things are kind of maybe easier to remember and easier to go through. So, as mentioned, this first touch was at the beginning of last December. And that time I had a couple of Java releases to be made and were kind of fed up with Travis because of their, they were trying to run the Travis CI org users to Travis CI.com, so basically paid accounts, which for my usage, there was no kind of, there's no reason to move or pay anything because things were working fine with the kind of public one. And yet, first of course, the screen support was needed because the one of the libraries that I was building and releasing was the Selenium library for robots framework written in Java. And then, because Java, there was also had to be released to Maven Central for people to use those, and the secrets and PGP, there were secrets for PGP keys and Sonatype credentials at the beginning, because of course release can't be done without without those. Then, and I have to mention that the Travis configuration was quite old, so the Travis was taken to use when there was only, at least at the org side, had only Linux available. And then there were some times that those builds were in Travis were failing because they, for example, took out some Ubuntu distros or the JDK or Oracle JDK 8 was kind of just dropped without. Well, there might have been some information, but at least that didn't came with mail. So just noticed when the build was going, okay, now I have to start to fixing the Travis builds. But yeah, so those were made way back. Travis currently supports, I think, also Windows and Mac machines also at the org site. But that was thing that was new with GitHub Actions, so immediately those to use. And then with the Selenium, this first library, we also were able to put easily the Java 8 and 11 there, so both. And that was also tried with Selenium library, but that didn't play very well. And then the reporting parts, which actually was not touched at all. So GitHub Actions has quite nice storage for the artifacts. So for example, HTML reports from tests or any kind of reports that tests are the builds are generating. But the issue is that those are only published as a zip packages, and all artifacts are at single zip package. So, because we had those quite big HTML reports from tests, we liked to, or wanted to see those a bit easier way, and that's why we pushed those things to Netlify, and got immediately kind of free service to show up the reports, and no issues with the storage usage or anything. And then pushing the things to GitHub status, because the Netlify links are not, well, they are auto-generated like Docker container names. So it was nice to get some same place as the actual run, also the link to the report. And then Maven site publishing was one thing that that was also done, which had to be this because the GitHub Actions by default contain token to the GitHub, but that token doesn't have rights or power to make the site publishing actions. So separate, it's kind of stupid to have actions at the GitHub and you get the GitHub token, but that token can't be used. With especially with this kind of closely bound to the GitHub because the site is published to GitHub pages. So it basically just runs in the same repo, but this token is not able to trigger some actions which are required by the by the kind of the site publishing thing. So it's not enough to get things at the branch. GitHub also required some a bit more. But yeah, then the kind of other thing. Or actually going to the example. Nope.
Okay.
So basically, this is the first try. Of course, yeah, you can see that, hey, this is at the mid of December, but that's the time that the finally rebased, completely merged action was put here. So yeah, normal things that were seen previously, name of the action. When we are doing this, at the moment, of course, the normal things that can think are push and pull request. And if you're putting both, the issue is that there's the double building. But there's also thing with this push and difference between push and pull request, of course, that even though both show the same commit ID for the start, the pull request is not really building that commit. It's building the merge commit with the target branch, which is kind of hiddenly made, but there is a difference. But yeah, I like to use the latest one, just so there's no need to manually go there. Might be a bad habit, but there's also some laziness there. Then, as mentioned, we are having the matrix of two Java version, 8 and 11. And then we just basically go through all those matrix elements, so in this case two, one OS, two Java versions, by getting the code, getting the Java version, building the things, and then is kind of the interest, or well, a bit more interesting part. So this first part is of course done always when there is push event, but the release is actually made only if we are at the develop, when we basically push snapshot to the to this Maven central, or if we are getting it back, then we are making the release to the Maven central. So just that's why there's two places. And we always require that build and test is completed before we can make the release. And then kind of normal things. Again, checking things out, setting Java up, and then using action to make the publish. And yeah, you might notice that here I just mentioned that no branches or no tags. But I said this is from mid-December. I think it was later December than there was blog post about this. Okay, blog post noticing the security thing related to the pure tag or branch usage, that you never know what you are getting. And actually also this specific action was broken before changing this digest. It was broken also with this tag, because they are of course updating. Version 1 is version 1 major, and there was, I think, maybe 5 different minor patch version combinations released, and the latest one at that point broke things completely, which is of course quite hard for maybe for understand that, hey, I have here tag, why it fails still? What is changed? I haven't changed anything. And yeah, the secrets which are needed. And because moving away from Travis, we get rid of two in this case, 4 in case of the virtual screen needed. And I think if getting diff also a bit more simpler thing. So with Travis, there had to be separately this PGP key handling, getting Maven. Might be that this has also changed because this is kind of even older. This is quite old file for the Travis configuration. But I think still these, there were stages, I think, which were still kind of showing something still under development. But yeah, a bit kind of different kind of thing, and at least currently I like reading of the this GitHub action part more. And there's no need to have those, especially this Maven settings XML or some deployment scripts created. Yeah. So then we got there. And we were basically at first touches. Then at the reporting part, so, and the other things. So basically going, skipping directly to the latest build that we had. Yeah, still same OS, same Java versions. And then this one had the only this publishing site. So as you see, thing is that there is a secret for the token, but the token doesn't have rights. So for the site, there had to be different token. Different token given. So personal access token generation, and that's it. And then quickly going to the other one when finding the other screen here. Yeah. So as mentioned, the other thing that I tried this with was the Selenium library. So basically I needed to make tests with the browsers, which mostly require a screen to be available. So, but here we have so three different OSs, again, just latest versions. Hopefully those OS changes are not breaking ones. Then we need to specify some things. So for example, kind of funny that, normal thing, Windows and macOS have screens already available, so these GUI things can be run in those. With Linux, there has to be XVFB, or it's easier to have XVFB installed and use that one. And then there are some dependencies which are depending on the OS, how to install those. So Linux, XVFB zip and curl, Windows. Also browsers, because even though GitHub Actions, these runners have browsers available, those two are not at each and every one. So it's better to ensure that there are browsers which are the latest versions. But nicely, those runners have the Chocolate Yum and Brew installed, so it's quite easy to get things to those. And yeah, again, same things, checking out things, setting up Java, making those kind of other dependencies which are needed for the runner to be okay, so installing dependencies and setting display. And these, it's basically execute those according to OS or the criteria given here. So there's different things for different OSs, and even though there is no set display at Windows or Mac, it doesn't fail here, so it just goes through. Then building with the specific browser. So the browser is also one element for this matrix. So we have three OSs, one Java version, three browsers. So basically 9 builds each time. And then more about that at robot framework side, but the robot first generates the output XML, which then is used to produce HTML reports. And the output XML is basically not needed anymore when the generation is done, and it's also quite big. So we are deleting it on Windows and Unix-like systems separately. And here we have these kind of things that were mentioned, that if always. It kind of looks funny. Okay, if always is basically always true, so why it has to be mentioned? The thing is that if things fail before this this specific step, upcoming steps are not executed unless they are said always executed. So yeah, always even there is failures before execute this and this. And then archive the results only if the status is failure. So again, we have to say always first, because otherwise this step is not even tried to execute. And then we also require that it's the status is currently failure. And then we are doing the upload results to Netlify 2, creating some kind of nice redirection index HTML, so the report is, or the link to the host is directly going to the report. And then GitHub status update, so we push the mentioned link to the GitHub status. So there's now two, each run, which is failing, produce two lines, one from GitHub Actions and one from this status update, update. yeah, and here we use also the default token because these runs are fast enough, so those tokens are still available and alive. And then again, the release part requiring build and test, having some other branches to build with. No need to install any funny things because we are not interested in testing anymore at this stage. Which kind of made a bit issue also, because at Travis you had possibility to just, even though the build was failed, you had possibility to start the different stages manually. So for example, even though tests fail, you were able to start the release job manually, kind of knowing, okay, I know that this works, but Travis again just made some funny things, so I want to release, and that was possible. With GitHub Actions, it's not. So always when things are failing, your only possibility is to run all steps again. Of course, it just can be said it's just part of the how you organize your workflow, so there wouldn't be too big things to, or too kind of big run to be made again. But for example, here we had kind of quite many of these steps, but only possible solution for rerunning is rerun all. Again, this example is bad because I think that this was just some incorrectly made thing, but still kind of the idea is that even I have only one missing or kind of failing job, and there's basically no dependencies between jobs there built in that way, there's still no possibility to just say, okay, rerun. For example, Sonatype release had sometimes be quite sluggish, so it has failed. So just rerunning the test again, and that's it. Yeah, so. And yeah, so that basically movement from Travis to GitHub Actions, and I have made that basically every Java application or library I have moved it with the really, when I have made release now after this December, I have moved those to GitHub Actions. It just kind of feels much nicer compared to Travis. Even though I think all of these things that are presented could have been made also with Travis side, but nicer to be in one place. Yeah. And then the other big thing, so I tried first this Maven library publishing at December, and then there was discussion at Robot Frameworks Slack channel related to this, okay, the CI has been asked for ages, would this be the way to create that? And yeah, of course, when I knew what there was and knew that this was simple and free, especially free was important thing, we decided to, okay, try with that and the support for Windows and Mac, because of course Linux offering has been there for ages, but Windows and Mac are a bit newer ones. But yeah, so first touches again. we started with putting everything in single file, which might work if all of your actions are taking about equal set of time, and if GitHub Actions would allow you to run single jobs inside the workflow instead of just rerun everything. But yeah, the issue was that there was a test that the duration was from 15 seconds to 3 hours. So if one of your 50 second things fail, you don't necessarily want to run that 3 hour thing also. And also Windows had interesting issues. This was actually quite interesting to figure out, because the Python code that was tested was not really liking, maybe it was Python in general doesn't like all the code pages Windows offer. Even though this 65001 supposed to see almost like UTF-8, the keyword is almost. And at desktop Windows, the code base is 850, which was also quite okay. This software is usually run at desktop Windows also, so maybe it's better to support or check the support for 850 and not try to fix everything related to this 65001. But yeah, so we noticed that there was something that needs to be checked. So the rearranging things was the biggest thing. So the C, Python, and PyPy were put in one file. They are quite fast to run. Chython on the other file, and at the beginning also the Iron Python in one file. And then there were some screen tests, so XVFP, of course. And the XML output removal, which was already seen at the previous example. So this is kind of hard to say which comes from. So some implementations of the actions at Java side I made before, but then those I like to rebase the things before merging to the master or developer, and see, so that's why it's hard to say which comes at which order. So it might kind of sound a bit funny that, okay, it was just presented, but that's the reason. And yeah, here the last part, reporting. So the Netlify was the big help here, because those reports were quite big. I think that the zip file for reports was about 15 megabytes. It was quite annoying to download and unzip and then kind of open things, and not nice, and especially not easy to kind of give the developer a link that, hey, this is the failing test, can you check it? And then the token thing. I mentioned previously that we needed this separate token for the site publishing, but also we needed separate token for Chython test report publishing, because these tokens that are given by GitHub Actions are valid only 1 hour. And as you might guess from the first step, the Chython test were the ones that took 3 hours. So if those were failed, they were basically passed, they were able to publish the artifacts, but not this nice net, and they were, of course, with the Netlify token, the Netlify things, but they were not able to publish the link to the Netlify, because the status API was not able to be called. Yes, I think that's more. And at the when these slides are published, I have the links also for the different stages here. But I think that with the previous examples, you kind of got the enough touch to the GitHub Actions to be able to make the nice questions. Yep. So, but then, what's kind of my feelings when I have used this GitHub Actions to create the one big Python CI and multiple Java things? So, and recommendations also. So, multiple workflows is usually better than one. Of course, there are issues with this copy pasting, and that's at least my feeling, that that's the only way to kind of use common parts to copy paste things. So that's something which might be improved. Then the personal access tokens are needed for the longer runs because of this expiration thing. And there was no other workaround for it. So it is quite, well, it would be nice to have some way to extend those tokens. Of course, in this case, the single step at the workflow takes that 2.5 hours. So it somehow has to basically just get the longer token. And yeah, the reports are only in single package. So if there's multiple HTML files, or even there's just one HTML file, it's still zip package, so you have to extract it. This is something that GitHub forums at least contain that this is, they are kind of focusing on this, or trying to make something more of this. And the GitHub Actions, the front page that shows how many passed and failed, even that wasn't there December, so they are really updating. And then, in a way, good thing for security. The secrets are not usable in forks, which is nice. But there are actually two big issues with this. First, other one is not so big. The report releasing is not working from forks because the secret for Netlify is only at the kind of origin repo. But then the GitHub token, which is given to forks, of course, get their own GitHub token, which doesn't have any access to the originating repo. So basically, when someone creates PR, the originating repo contains the statuses and the runs, but those are not at the PR, because the token, which is created at the fork side, doesn't have rights to push the origin's status anything. Which probably is going to be fixed, but then maybe it's not fixed because of this. It's basically the same secret than secret that you are yourself giving. And then about the triggers. I mentioned that push and pull request triggers are different, even though it seems that you, when using both without any closer filters or criteria, it seems that it's building the same two times same things. But as I said, that's not the case, because when checking the checkout step, it actually shows that, hey, it gets the target branch also and makes the merge there, which is just kind of hidden, and it just basically has to be known. But the resulting thing with those is these double runs, and it's not really a big issue at the public side. It might be annoying at the private side when you are paying for the execution and you are using most of your time to make obsolete runs at macOS with this 10-time multiplier. And yeah, the single job rerun is missing. So I said, you have to run everything again. Of course, with the 20 concurrent runs, it's nicer than with 10 or less concurrent runners, but still, it would be nice to just kind of, yes, releasing can be done, and yes, you can retry releasing without making all the tests again, if it was just sonotype issue. And this is more about the private side, so there are those multipliers, which basically 1 minute at macOS is 10 minutes at your paid time, and 2 minutes at Windows. 1 minute at Windows is 2 minutes at your paid time. And again, many of these things are not so at public side, because, well, you can wait if you don't have multi-hundred matrix thing. Yeah, links going to be more. And then time for the questions.